Hello everyone and welcome to another video. Now this is Alienware's Alpha gaming PC. With the first iteration releasing back in 2014, this later model, nicknamed the R2, is a slightly more up-to-date and powerful addition to Dell's tiny lineup. At just 7.9 by 7.9 inches wide and 2.2 inches deep, the Alpha offers the power of a PC in an aesthetically pleasing, console-sized package. This particular model features a Core i7-6700T, Skylake-based CPU, 8GB of DDR4 as well as a Radeon R9 M470X GPU. A GTX 960-based version of this machine is also available. So why did I pick this one? Well, despite releasing just a couple of years ago, used Alienware Alphas can be found at a fraction of their original and quite frankly steep price, though you'll still see far better value building your own gaming PC with used parts from scratch. After all, just because it's a fraction of its original price doesn't mean it's now a good price. That being said, not everyone wants to build a PC themselves, and you don't have to put together your own machine to be a PC gamer. Though teaching yourself the pretty simple practice will help you navigate the sometimes treacherous minefield of self-diagnosing any system problems that could arise. The look of this machine sort of ties into that statement. I like the simplistic console vibes this thing gives off, though it's super satisfying all the same to know I can take the lid off and tinker with it in a technical emergency. Let's talk more about the specs. For the £300 I paid for this thing, I got myself the quad-core i7 model that features 8 threads. Clocked at 2.8GHz, this processor should still be pretty good for CPU-intensive tasks and video editing, not to mention gaming, of course. Some of you have probably never heard of the graphics card, but the M470X is essentially a rebranded R7-260X. The Alpha R1 had a GTX 860, which was pretty much identical in performance to a 750 Ti, the legendary budget graphics card that can still handle itself quite well in some modern scenarios. Before we check out performance, I want to talk a little more about the design and software. This specific PC features Windows 10 64-bit, which works fluently and fast thanks to the i7, and around the case itself we have a few essential ports, including two HDMI slots and a few USB ports as well. Getting straight into the gaming, and I decided to start with the newest release, Shadow of the Tomb Raider. A AAA title which can look downright beautiful under the right circumstances. Unfortunately, no such scenario was replicated here. As for 1080p gaming, we had to turn things down to the low settings, and DirectX 11 worked better as well. The small size of the Alienware doesn't go unnoticed during gameplay though, and by that I mean the noise levels are incredible. It looks good, yeah, but the jet engine-like audio coming from this thing is enough to take away from the immersiveness of any game. If you wear headphones though, you needn't worry. As we continue our way through the benchmark here, you'll notice how the game's performance totally differs depending on the on-screen situation. I believe most, if not all, of this game takes place in the jungle, correct me if I'm wrong, which isn't ideal as far as the frame rate is concerned, and it's particularly the more settlement-orientated areas that will drag the performance way down. Also, take note of how the GPU is the bottleneck in this scenario, as it will continue this way throughout. More on that a little later. The average frame rate here, dead on 30. Moving on to PUBG, and I was pleasantly surprised to see 45 frames per second on average once again at 1080p with a mix of low and medium settings. Performance will likely differ depending on the map, but here it was certainly playable. Very low settings may mean a slightly higher average, but I'd rather not sacrifice the graphical quality any more than this. Whether you do so though is entirely up to you, of course. There will be some lag and slowdown during the initial skydive, and there were certainly a few drops when we plunged out of the plane and plunged into the mid-20s. But the game soon evened itself out once we were on the ground, and the frame rate remained fairly consistent over my full game playthrough. PUBG still sees regular updates, so performance will likely differ again by next week. Fallout 4 ran very similar. At 1080p with the medium settings, we saw 46fps. I chose this area of the map because it proves to be quite demanding and intensive on the system, especially as we make our way to the explosive-filled bridge a little later on. It's there where you'll see larger frame drops, but overall, I was fairly happy with today's Fallout 4 performance. Again, ideally low settings would be best, but it's all down to personal preference and how many frames are ideal for you. I don't think you'd see a solid 60fps at 1080p though regardless, thanks to the limitations of the aforementioned graphics card, but a resolution reduction may help out a little better here. Frame times were also okay, resulting in little stutter with this system. Sometimes stutter can be worse than a low frame rate because a smooth 30 would be better in my opinion than say a really juddery 45. Call of Duty World War II fared a little better with 55fps at normal settings. This result is entirely dependent on where you are on the map of course, but I tested a few different levels out and then combined the total figures to come up with the aforementioned average. It was an okay experience, but once again the M470X was the biggest letdown. In a lot of cases with pre-built systems, I find the graphics card becomes the limiting factor far quicker than the processor. For instance, I've still got a couple of Q6600 based systems that can still run Fallout 4, albeit with very reduced settings. Anyway, let's not get distracted. COD World War 2 here with the Alienware Alpha runs okay, but again is plagued by an extremely distracting background noise, something even a good system clean, a physical one that is, didn't solve. Next up, it's Assassin's Creed Odyssey. I ran the benchmark test here with the low preset and 1080p resolution and saw a spot on 30 frames per second. There were a few drops down to the mid 20s, and this is something that even a resolution drop couldn't really improve. Is it playable? Well, that depends. In wide open spaces, you'll get satisfactory performance, but as you approach built up settlements, you will see pretty poor frames, similar to how Tomb Raider ran. It's not ideal by any means, and considering the price that some of these machines still go for, you aren't getting fantastic value for money at all. I can't remember who said it, but we often mistake bad pricing for bad hardware, and the Alienware Alpha would be better if used models retailed for less money. After all, you could throw together a used Core i5 and 750 Ti system for less than most of these go for on average, and see identical performance. Not to mention better upgradability. And that's where we see the biggest issue. I mentioned earlier that a slightly better GTX 960 version is available, but even then it suffers from the same problem that this one exhibits, lack of an upgradable graphics card. See, just like the old Alienware laptop I reviewed a couple of months back, these little desktop machines feature soldered graphics cards. You can't remove them. Because of this, the GTX 960 based machine would be better to opt for because it supports the company's graphics amplifier, allowing you to connect an external GPU. But by the time you've bought that, as well as a new GPU to put inside the amplifier, you'd probably feel ripped off and disappointed, and wonder why you didn't build a custom PC from scratch. That's not to say GTX 960 isn't still a somewhat decent performer, it's just that you wouldn't want one forever.
So there we have it, guys. I apologise for the audio at the start of this one. The room where I usually record the sound is being redecorated by myself, so it sounds a little bit tinny in there. Hopefully that will all be rectified by the next video. Also, the fact that I look half dead is due to jet lag. I've just got back from Australia after spending a month out there, and the time change has really messed me up. But, as always, thank you for watching. To summarise, a used Alienware Alpha R2 certainly doesn't seem worth it, even if you can pick one up on the used market. The few that I did find here on eBay UK, as well as in eBay US, were still significantly overpriced, and your best bet should you want one for whatever reason would be to pick one up in an online auction, where you might be able to save a little more money as opposed to a buy it now or best offer option. When these released, of course being Alienware, they were slightly overpriced for the hardware that you got, but it's always been that way, and it continues to be that way not only with this particular brand but with other pre-built PCs too, though some companies do certainly add on lower premiums than others. In the case of the Alpha R2, just like its predecessor, I can't really see a point in purchasing one in 2018 because of the lack of an upgradable GPU, though that may have been obvious from the start when looking at this machine. You've only got to see the size of it to know that it's probably not going to have a fully fledged GPU in there, though I have seen similarly sized machines that do have upgradable graphics cards inside them, so If you are in the market for a small, compact and powerful PC, then please consider your options before going out and buying one of these. It's a good machine, don't get me wrong, for everyday usage and some light gaming, but it's certainly lacking in terms of what you can do with it moving forward into the future, and the fact that the GPU is soldered on will severely limit what games you can play, and those newer titles like Shadow of the Tomb Raider will start to struggle very much. As always though, thank you so much for watching. I wanted to sort of make an appearance at the end of the video, just because my upload schedule has been terrible lately, and that is due to the fact that I've been away the whole of November. But now, it's time to get back into the swing of things. Christmas is coming up soon, so I'll have a few different videos regarding buying guides for the festive season, stuff like that. But as always, thank you so much for watching. If you enjoyed it, leave a like on it. Leave a dislike if you didn't. Subscribe to the channel if you haven't done so already. And hopefully, I'll see you all in the next one.